Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Well, hello, everyone. Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, episode number 31. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco. Welcome to the show.
A special show today, Bob. We are releasing this on the Memorial Day weekend and kind of a tribute show and a thank you show to those that have served in the military and those that are currently serving.
Yeah, every time I think of, and we've spoken with a lot of veterans recently, you know, on the show, and it keeps coming back to me. I just want to thank our men and women in uniform because they sacrifice their lives of comfort at home with their family so that we can have that ourselves. And it makes me feel proud.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, a lot of American flags seen flying around this weekend, a lot of patriotic decorations. I know our neighborhood had a big Memorial Day neighborhood gathering, a fireworks show. So a lot of those patriotic things you think about, but it's something that we need to think about every day of the year, thanks to our military service folks as well as the veterans. And again, on behalf of myself and my family, I just want to say thank you as well to those who have served and are currently serving. A little apology here, Bob, first, as we begin the show. Our snafu, just not looking at the calendars properly. We had promoted last week that we were going to be talking to Ferrum Forge this week, knowing that we were going to have a Memorial Day kind of tribute show and kind of honor and salute the military service folks and the veterans. So our apologies. We'll have Ferrum Forge coming up, but we wanted to make sure that we had this this special show this weekend.
Yeah, it happens. It happens sometimes in work, and then it also happens in the important stuff like the podcast. So
yeah, a lot of times at work, but let's not go there. So anyway, I do want to remind folks that our podcast today is brought to you by a new sponsor, if you will. And this is kind of one near and dear to my heart because I'm not that much of a shopper, but I like saving money. So definitely you want to hear this. If you like getting cash back for your purchases, which I know I do, you'll want to use Ebates. And because you're a loyal Knife Junkie listener, if you're not already a member of Ebates, you'll get $10 for joining if you go to theknifejunkie.com/cashback. It's easy. I use Ebates Chrome extension. So whenever I go to eBay or an online merchant, Ebates will pop up and ask, do I want to use their link and save money? And well, duh, of course I do. So again, just go to theknifejunkie.com/cashback. Sign up. After you spend $25, you'll get $10. So theknifejunkie.com/cashback. Easy way to earn money on stuff you're already going to be spending on. And I know Amazon, eBay, a lot of online merchants, I can go through Ebates and save money. For Mother's Day, when I ordered a watch for my wife, I got back 10, 12 bucks, something like that. So easy peasy.
Nice. And you know, 10 bucks is some portion of a knife.
That's right. Every little bit helps.
That's
let me
right.
tell you that.
Exactly.
All right. So we've got this special show, Bob, military related, veteran related. We're going to talk about combat knives, knives in the military. Kind of set us up for this.
Yeah. Well, I'm thinking of knives that if someone came to me and said, I'm being deployed overseas and I want to take, you know, what knife should I bring? I'm going to be issued either a bayonet or a K-bar or whatever the knife is, but I want to bring something else. What should I bring? So these are some knives. This is a sort of a list of sample knives I put together, keeping in mind cost, because oftentimes on deployment, things I've heard get stolen, things get damaged badly, things get lost. My brother-in-law, James, was in the invasion of Iraq in 2003, and his bayonet got stolen.
Oh,
and he's in the United States Marine Corps, was at the time, I should say. And they were on some base with Army guys, and so he blamed it on the Army guys.
But, right.
But he had a cool M7 bayonet. He ended up giving me the sheath and bought a new M7 bayonet to put in it for my birthday about 10 years ago, I'd say.
Well, that was nice of him.
Yeah.
And I did want to kind of emphasize, we're not talking about art knives here, custom knives. I think you're going to kind of keep, like, what, 200 and below or something like that price point?
Yeah, 200 and below. Actually, I don't even think we quite reach 200.
Okay. All right.
But I'm also thinking about size and weight, Jim, because military folk have to carry a lot of gear around, especially, you know, especially if they're in combat and they're out in the field. And so you want to keep it capable but light and sizable, but not too big, I would imagine. You know, there's a lot of other things you carry around. There are a lot of great, large, oversized, heavy knives that would be more than capable in the field. But do you want to lug all that around when you have to lug other stuff around?
Right. Okay.
So size and weight.
Okay. Other criteria?
Yeah, these knives also have to be dual purpose. They have to be fighting knives and utility knives. Okay. Though mostly they'll probably be used for utility tasks, digging trenches, cutting wire, opening up crates and stuff like that. But it's still, it's war. It's combat. Right. You're a military person. You should have some sort of tactical capability in that knife too.
Multiple capabilities. Okay.
Yeah. And then finally a ratio, sort of a, and this is intuitive, like a durability to cost ratio.
The Knife Junkie scale.
Yeah, exactly. And I have to say, it's not fully thought through. It's not a scientific ratio. It is just a intuitive one. So I'm going to talk about all of these, but I want to set the stage with the K-bar. Okay. You've heard of the K-bar knife, yeah?
Sure, sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So the K-bar knife is the ubiquitous U.S. military knife. It was first created, invented, if you will, and came into service in 1942 for the Marine Corps. They, up until that point, had been using what was called the Marine Raider Stiletto, and it was apparently good for swift and silent killing, but they found that they had a lot of other tasks they had to do with it, and it was kind of just a fragile blade. And so they put out a request to different companies to come up with a fighting utility knife. So the knife was originally called, before it took on the K-bar moniker, it was simply called Knife Fighting Utility.
And I love that. That's a great name.
Yeah. So, I mean, that tells you right there in the name that it's a dual purpose tool. And the first purpose, if I'm hearing this correctly, is fighting. So it's built on a platform that can be, it's built on a combat fighting platform. And in America, what better fighting platform for a knife is there? The Bowie knife.
Hmm.
I'll answer it for you, Jim.
Okay, thanks.
I jumped in a little too fast. But yeah, so they settled on the Bowie style blade. It's 7 inches long. It's got a sharpened clip on the back. It's not just a clip in shape. It's not just a scooped out piece of steel, but it is a sharpened back edge, and that's a fighting thing. The rest of the knife, it had a thicker blade. It had a, instead of a heavy, like cast metal handle of its predecessor, they used stack leather washer handles. And it made it much lighter, more comfortable in the hand, and grippier.
Grippier is good.
Yeah, grippier is good if you're in the jungle or...
Yeah.
Now, then again, the problem they had with that in the jungle and wet environments is that, that stacked leather does not hold up well in humidity, and especially near seawater.
Okay.
But for the period of time you're there and for what you're using it for, I think it was more than adequate. The blade, 7 inches, 1095. We've talked about 1095 a lot here, which is just a tough metal, you know, and it's easily resharpened, and that's what you want in the field too. You want something that you can sharpen because you're using it a lot. And you know, if you go out in the field with some sort of super steel, like something modern like M390, it will take a lot longer to get dull, but once it does, it will take a lot more work to get sharp.
Okay.
So you want something that's a little more easily serviceable. Right. So the K-bar was perfect for this.
You mentioned sharpening in the field, and a question popped in my mind. I mean, how do you sharpen your knife in the field in that situation?
When the K-bar first came out in 1942, people were, I'm sure, carrying around little stones with them, sharpening stones.
Okay.
But today, you could carry any number of small sharpening implements from, you know, modern manufacturers. But, you know, few things beat a good stone.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just envisioning what, you know, back in the day, you're out in the jungle and you pick up a rock off the ground or something, you know, and start. I mean, is that realistically or realistic?
Sure, sure. You can use shale. Wait, is it shale? You know what? I don't want to speak about something I don't know, but I've seen videos of people putting sand, wet sand, on shale and then kind of doing a stropping motion, which to me seems like it would give you quite a toothy edge, just put it that way. But, you know, right. if you need to resharpen that thing and you're in the jungle and you need to hack through vines or whatever.
All right. Sorry to take us off track.
No, not at all. There is no off track.
It's all knives.
So, yeah. So the K-bar was first given to Marines who were doing reconnaissance or engineering units, but then also anyone who was armed with a 1911 pistol, like a commander or something like that, or anyone who carried an M1 carbine or a BAR, you know, one of those big giant rifles. Everyone else who just carried the M1 Garand, they were issued a bayonet, so they didn't get a K-bar, at least right off the bat. So there was a need for a fighting knife. And this is something I want to keep in mind because I mention this often, but in the knife community dialogue, people look a little askew at the idea of the weapon as a knife. But when we're talking about the possibility of combat or the definite impending doom of combat, having something that is a weapon, but that can also open up crates is essential. So the K-bar really excelled at that.
Well, if we are talking combat knives, I mean, you know, yeah, it's two words there. And the first one is combat. So you need to be able to use it in that function. So
exactly. So a number of different American companies were licensed to make the pattern. They made several million of them, or have made several million of them over the years. So a funny thing, Jim, the lore of how K-bar came into being, the name K-bar.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
The Union Cutlery Company, which is the company that ended up taking on the name K-bar, had got a letter from a fur trapper, and it was not written very well and also in damaged condition. But he told in this letter about how he killed a bear that he had wounded with a rifle that jammed. Okay. So the bear came at him, and he was able to kill it with his knife.
Was that a bar he killed?
He killed a bar. And the letters that they could see in this fragment of a letter were K-A space B-A-R, so K-bar. So at least that's the lore that they...
Right. That's their story, and they're sticking to it.
Exactly. So a bunch of different companies like Ontario and Camillus and other companies made the K-bar. But a funny thing, Case Knives, very, very big, prominent American knife company, also tried to get a contract, and they never were awarded a contract to make the K-bars. But they many years later, in a commemorative move, came out with a limited edition of the K-bar prototypes that they created for competition in 1942 and sold it to the public. And they were manufactured by Ontario, which I think is funny.
Yeah, all goes around, comes around.
That's right. So anyway, everything I'm talking about is kind of keeping in mind the lineage of the K-bar fighting utility knife for military knives that you might want to take on deployment.
Mm. Okay. All right. So where do we start? Where do we begin?
So I'm going to start with the most K-bar-like knife that is not a K-bar out there. That is a very reasonable price and extremely capable. And it's the Ontario Spec Plus. And now that's a line of knives made by Ontario Knife Company in New York. And the Spec Plus line are 1095 bladed knives in familiar military patterns that and the SP1 is a perfect example. It's a 7-inch K-bar like knife that they produce. And the blade looks essentially identical to a K-bar blade, except it lacks the fuller in the side of the blade, and the handles are soft, kind of craton, grippy, contoured handles that have really good retention, kind of like more comprehensive retention in the hand than the traditional K-bar. So the SP1 would make an outstanding knife to take on deployment if you're worried about the stacked leather handle on your K-bar getting jacked up in the environment.
A ballpark price range on those, and I think you were going to try to do some price categorization on these as we go?
Yeah. So now we are in the $50 range, and these knives are in the $50 range. They have several others in this line. One is the Marine Raider Bowie, which is a big, impressive Bowie. It's also $50. 1095 steel is just good to go in any sort of survival toughness situation where blade steel toughness is needed. And, you know, in these big knives, you're swinging and hacking and chopping. You never know when you're going to hit a rock or something. You don't want the whole thing to shatter. You just want it to roll or to chip. And that's what you're going to get more often with this kind of steel. Mm-hmm. And plus, Ontario, the company that makes this, has a rich history of contracting knife manufacturing for the United States Armed Forces. And
okay. So I'm sorry. Yeah. So Ontario makes the Spec Plus, the SP1 Plus, the Marine Raider Bowie?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And so that the Marine Raider Bowie is another knife in their Spec Plus line. So
gotcha.
Here, just a little testimony from me about the quality of Ontario things. I have a Ontario machete. I may have told this story before in this podcast, but I have a Ontario machete made for the Army, the U.S. Army, that I got in an Army surplus store in the early 80s. It was when I saw Conan the Barbarian. I got my brother to take me to the Army-Navy store, and I bought the closest thing to a sword I could get.
Right.
That machete stuck around the house forever. It was always in the garage. It got used a lot in the woods and in the backyard, clearing brush and stuff. And one year, this was about 10 years ago, I was a man of 35 or so. I'm giving myself a couple extra years. Anyway,
right.
I was home visiting my parents. There was a big oak tree that fell across a path. My dad and I went back out there with an axe, with two axes, and started chopping, and it was taking forever. I said, let me go get the machete. I got this Ontario machete and chopped this tree in half. Well, not in half, but I chopped through the tree to clear the path in no time. And it was really? It was about a 14-inch thick tree.
Wow.
Yeah, it was amazing. It's fast and light. The Ontario machete is just the best one out there.
Wow. Cool.
Yeah. So sticking in this sort of $50 range, another great option that is smaller, but very capable, and I think it's a handsome knife, and it comes from a company that you don't hear me talk about often, but it's a SOG knife. The SOG Seal series of knives, especially the Seal Pup, which is a 4.5-inch clip point blade with that classic SOG profile with the double humps on the back of the bowie. It's a beautiful looking knife. It comes in Aus 8, which, you know, we all know is not the greatest steel, but it is also an easily resharpened steel. It takes a great edge, and you can get an edge back on it really quickly. Mm-hmm. And so that's good for the field.
Mm-hmm.
You can get them with serrations and serrations I'm not a big fan of often, but for this purpose, you're using your knife a lot. Maybe you don't have a chance to sharpen it, or you're not good at sharpening it. It's nice to know that you have those teeth that remain sharp for much longer. If you need to cut through cord, you need to cut through a seatbelt or something.
Oh, okay. Like that. Yeah. Yeah. Good point. Good point.
Yeah. So it's a trusted pattern. It's a time tested pattern. And there are many sheath options. Well, I shouldn't say many. There are two exceptional sheath options. The one it comes with is actually quite nice. The cheaper model, the $40 model, comes in a very stout nylon sheath with a big pouch on the front. You can fit a Leatherman multi-tool or a sharpening stone or something in there. Or you could get the a Kydex sheath for it. So, yeah, you don't hear me talk about SOG often, and that's for a reason. They have some, frankly, really goofy-looking models. And even in the Seal Pup line, they have one called the Seal Strike, which I don't know. It looks like a 13-year-old boy designed it. I don't know how else to put it.
Right.
And this is coming
I'm sorry to interrupt. I was going to say I don't think I've ever heard SOG. You talk about that on the podcast. So, yeah.
SOG is an interesting company. They're born out of the reproduction of a knife that was used by the Special Observations Group, I think they were called, in Vietnam, a special reconnaissance group.
SOG.
Yeah. And they had a special knife made for them. And then a gentleman, I don't remember his name, in the 80s sort of resurrected that pattern from a historical sample and had a bunch made. In Seki, Japan, I believe, which is a great place to have a knife made, and started the company based on reproducing that SOG knife. And now that's the name of the company, and it's on all of their products. Actually, right. It's all over all of their products. That's one of the main complaints about them. Oh. SOG on the clip, SOG on the blade, SOG on the handle, SOG in the pattern of the grip texture on the side of the, you know, SOG everywhere.
A lot of billboarding, huh?
Exactly. Yeah. But got to say that Seal Pup and the Pup Elite, great knives.
Okay. So where do we go from here? Are we still in the $50-ish category?
Well, now we're going to bump it up a little bit. We're going to talk about cold steel, which is an obvious choice for any sort of hard situation. That sounded like an ad. An obvious choice for any hard situation. But cold steel, the SRK, which stands for survival rescue knife, is a time-tested, well-loved knife. And this knife has been around in their product line for some 20 years, I think. and hasn't really changed except now you can buy it in a variety of steels. The one that I have is the lower end one. It's a $42 knife. It's a SK5 steel, and then it goes up to VG10 Sanmai for 135 and CPM3V, which is a really great outdoors knife steel for 145 bucks.
You know how I love it when you talk of those letters and number combination.
That's so awesome. but the cool thing about this knife is that it's a 6-inch. It's so simple. It's a 6-inch clip point blade, and it's not a very dramatic clip point blade with a grippy Kraton handle. It's no frills. It's not going to win any beauty contests, but it is a extremely capable knife and neutral in a way. And what I mean by that is the handle is neutral. It will accommodate any grip, and the blade, though a clip point, is a very neutral kind of blade too. A lot of straightness to the blade, and then just a little bit of belly towards the tip and a stout tip, and you can do a lot of work with it, as opposed to a tanto, which might require you to change up your techniques or something like that. Mm-hmm. So just an all-around universal knife. Now, speaking of tantos, if that is your thing, and they are very field useful, they're not just for assassinations. The Recon Tanto is the sort of tanto brother to the SRK. Same handle, just a slightly longer blade at 7 inches, and a ferocious tanto. It's got a nice belly. It's got an outstanding tip. And that also has three versions with three different steels, one starting at $42 and then working your way up to about 155 bucks. It's, you know, if you have a little bit of extra money to spend, you know, you can go there. But if not, you know, you can get a $42 SRK or Recon Tanto and know that it's going to, have your back. And you can watch endless and infinite YouTube videos on these knives, because they've been around for so long. They've been tested and tested and tested, and not just by the folks at Cold Steel, but by YouTubers and bro scientists all over the world.
Truly field tested, if you will.
Yes, yeah. Indeed.
Well, you said it might not win any design awards or beauty awards, but it was built and designed for its function. So very, very capable knife, it sounds like.
Exactly. And just, the rest of the Cold Steel line, you know, as most people know, is vast. And a lot of it, most of it, due to their owner and chairman, Lynn Thompson's tastes are weapons.
I'm sorry. Taste.
Tastes and taste. Well, I mean, he has experience in knife fighting, all these different martial arts and stuff. So he designs weapons primarily.
Background interest, yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of what he's all about.
Yeah. Exactly. So if you're looking for a weapon, or if you're looking for just an outdoor tool kind of knife, and you have a limited budget, you can find something from them.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So are we still in this 50-ish category? Are we going to step it up a little bit? Or
yeah, well, that was the, we were making it up into the
okay. Okay.
Like that. So we're going to stay right around there. And I just want to let people know, if you want to get a traditional USMC K-bar with the leather sheath and the leather stacked handle, you can still get that for 85 bucks. And though it doesn't sport the super modern materials, they're still extremely capable. And I might add handsome knives. So you can still get a K-bar, K-bar branded and such. Here's another brand that you never hear me talk about. And well, I did a video where I was talking kind of sideways about one of their knives, and that's Gerber. Gerber, let me just say, when I was a kid in the 80s, there used to be a knife store. Yes, a knife store at our mall, a legit knife store.
Knife store?
Not just a Mall Ninja knife store. It was Remington, and they sold kitchen knives and outdoor knives and cool folding knives and such. And I used to go and lust after the Gerbers, the LMF, the BMF, which I could only imagine what that was named after. But these were big outdoor knives, and they all looked kind of like, what was being carried in Rambo and Commando in those movies. And at the time, they were great knives. They were made in Oregon, and somewhere along the way, they lost their compass. They started doing everything overseas, and they lost the respect of the knife community. I'm not going to say straight across the board, but in an era where people were really pushing the materials that they wanted to use and design and function, Gerber went through a real cheap phase, and they're working their way out of it now, especially with some of their recent releases in 2019.
Okay. All right.
But a knife I've heard consistently good things about, even through all of that, is the LMF and the Strong Arm. Those they're two knives that look very similar, and they've gotten great reviews and endorsements by people who, you know, are actual users and operators. Oddly enough, both knives have a 420HC steel, which is, you know, passable, but they must heat treat it in such a way that it's, you know, I don't know. The 420HC makes me look a little askance, but it's a 4.8-inch blade, very stout and very utilitarian-shaped kind of drop point. And they are both meant for hard use. The Strong Arm is kind of, I think, considered a little bit more of a outdoors knife, a survival knife, whereas the LMF is specifically made for escape and evasion, but escape from like helicopters and stuff like that. It's stout, you know. So it's heavy, but it's like a pry bar. And so, yeah, it was built extra stout and developed in the field for egress and survival. That's
okay. Before we move on or continue this conversation, I do want to remind our listeners that this is a special, first word that came to mind was tribute show, and I guess that's as good as any, just a special thank you show to the men and women who currently serve, but also the veterans of our U.S. Armed Services and military forces around the world. Thanks for your service. And we're kind of using the Memorial Day holiday weekend to kind of show our respect to those that in the military and served in the military by taking a look at some of the knives that have been and maybe will continue to be used in combat, the combat knives. And Bob started off with a little history lesson on the K-Bar, and we're moving into some of the knives currently available. But if you have a knife that you have comments about, or maybe you don't hear Bob talk about and you want to suggest it, give us a call on our listener line at 724-466-4487. Again, that's 724-466-4487. Leave us a message on there. We'd love to hear your thoughts, and we'd love to play it back on an upcoming edition of the Knife Junkie podcast and share your wisdom with the listeners of the Knife Junkie podcast. Bob, where do we go from here? You're talking about the Gerber LMF and the Gerber Strong Arm. So where do we go from here?
Well, those are in about the $80 to $90 range. They're somewhere right in there. Now we're moving up into the rarefied air of at least of this list, because like I said at the outset, I can't imagine taking anything too expensive out there that right. you might lose, you know. Then again, you know, these are outstanding.
If money's no object, yeah, there's
no
something
object
for you.
Yeah. Or maybe you're in a situation where you have more control over your space and can control what you hold on to. I don't know. It's hard for me to say because I've never been in the military.
Generally. Right.
I can only go on stories that friends and family have told me.
Right. All right.
But now we're in the kind of 115 to 160 range. I know that's not a codified range, but this is the range of the knives I'll be talking about here. And these are the SE knives. SE has a wide range of knives, you know, for adventure and outdoors. And
I'm sorry, Bob, that's the letters S and the letter C?
Oh, no, SE. E-S-E-E.
Oh, okay. E-S-E-E.
And
okay.
Damn it, it stands for something and I don't remember what it is. I should have written it down. But their most popular line are the SE4. There's an SE3, 4, 5, 6, and I think a 7. And then a big one called the Hunglis. Can't remember what that one's called either. But we're talking here about the SE4, 5, and 6. And they have sort of corresponding blade sizes. The 4 is 4.5 inches. The 5 is 5.5. And I think the 6 is 6 inches. But these are all 1095 full tang bladed knives. Again, 1095 for an outdoor knife. Excellent. You see a lot of makers using that, and it's coated so that, you know, 1095 being a high carbon steel is prone to corrosion. And so they coat it with the black traction coating, and the blade shapes are these just very, again, here comes this word, neutral. They're all purpose sort of drop point blades. They have a serrated option. You know, you can get them serrated if you want them serrated, which again, I think is a good idea if it's something, a tool you're relying on daily and you might not have a chance to strop or sharpen, just to know that you have the capability of those sharp teeth there in case you need to extract yourself from something. It's good to have. And these knives all have G10 or micarta handles. And you know I'm a sucker for micarta, Jim.
I like it too.
Yeah. The look and feel is fantastic, but also in terms of utility, it seems to get grippier when wet. And so, you know, whether you're in the rain or you have blood on your hands or oil on your hands or whatever it is, micarta is gonna do you good. And I was reading about the SE5, which to me is the most appealing. It is the stoutest of the three. It also has a noggin cracker on the back, or a what do you want to call it? A glass breaker on the back that I like. But the knife was designed as an Air Force SEER with the aid of an Air Force SEER instructor. SEER stands for Survival, Evasion, Resistance, and Escape. And it's training you go through, especially as a pilot, because you're a high value target flying over the enemy lines. So if you go down, it's the training. And this knife, the SE5, was created with that specific goal in mind, extracting yourself from the canopy of a downed aircraft and then using that knife to survive. And if need be, you know, use it as a weapon. So the SE5.
Okay. And awesome. I did a quick Google search while you were chatting, and it looks like I was on SE, the website, SE Knives, and in their About section, it seems like the two guys, Jeff Randall, Mike Perrin, working under contract with the Peruvian Air Force's, I can't even pronounce it, their School of Jungle Survival, essentially, also known by the acronym ESSEL. And so then I guess that's how the SE brand came out of that, as they were working with the Escuela de Supervención en la Selva. I don't know. School of Jungle Survival. So anyway, yeah.
They used to go by, I think, Randall's Adventure Training also. That's where you get the rat in the rat model one.
Yeah. Yeah. Their banner says Randall's Adventure Training and Equipment Group. Yeah. And then it has SE, big, bold in their logo there. So yeah.
So now
I found that interesting. Yeah. Sorry for the digression there.
Not at all. But before they became SE and they were still going by Randall's Adventure Training, they had their big knife was the RAT or the RTAC 2. And I have that here. It hangs on the leg of my desk. As a matter of fact, it's a massive 10-inch outdoor blade. And it's, man, I've always loved this thing.
In case the zombies get down to the basement, you've got a weapon.
Yeah, oh, I got more than one. Yeah, the zombies don't want to come down here. I really recommend those SE knives. And my experience with them is limited to this RTAC and then also an SE6 that I handled. That's the 6-inch version of it. Now, once you get beyond the 6, I would say it might be a little big and a little heavy, given the rest of what you're probably going to be carrying. But those are really great, stout, no-nonsense survival knives.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And again, in that, I can't think of the word I was going to try to say, but that non-traditional range of $115 to $160. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's
some of the more expensive knives you're going to be talking about today.
Exactly. And that's loosely based on just going to Blade HQ and looking.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So the last of the fixed blades that are expensive that I'm going to talk about, and by expensive, I mean hovering around 100, but going up to, you know, they have a couple of knives in the 200s. This brand reminds me of a slightly different kind of cold steel. I'll put it that way. And that is Topps Knives, probably my favorite production fixed blade knife company. Topps Knives, and the reason I say they're like cold steel is that they have a huge product line. I mean, huge. And every model always seems available, which is weird to me. And they have a small shop in Idaho. And by small, I mean, you know, they're not a gigantic factory. They have a manufacturing capability to put out a lot of knives, but it seems somewhat humble, I got to say. Like, it's not a giant operation. Anyway, they make such amazing knives. Most of them they're all full tang knives except for their folders, and they're mostly 1095, though they use a 154 cm like on the Rapid Strike, which I did a review on recently. That's stainless. Some of their blades they choose to use 154, but mostly it's 1095 coated with traction coating, and they're just solidly built. And mostly they use micarta for the handles, and they're nice to look at. And I'm getting up in a lather
here,
Jim.
You're getting gushy, yes.
Okay, so the company was started by 12 different kind of law enforcement and military operators came together. Wow. and created their very first knife. Was this giant, massive tanto with a huge sawback called the Steel Eagle. And they still make that knife in a variety of sizes. It's a huge knife. And since their inception, I believe Leo Espinoza, who's a guy I would love to talk to on this show, he is their president. I'm not sure if the other 11 guys are still involved or what the deal is with that. But man, they make some amazing, amazing knives. And I'll just give you a couple examples. The Cut 4, it's called, C-U-T. It's a knife with a dual purpose. It's an outdoors knife that doubles as a tactical knife. It's a very nice drop point with a pretty acute point, pretty stabby point, but very utilitarian blade. But it's got a karambit ring at the back, which comes in handy for retention, period. You know, whether you're using it as a karambit and, you know, getting in some sort of a C-lot duel, or if you're out there and you're just carving wood, you know, it's a great knife. The Rapid Strike, as I did a review on recently, is a wonderful little covert shiv, if you will, and you can get it double-edged. It's got a glass breaker. I ground the glass breaker off of mine because I didn't like the way it felt on my thumb in reverse grip, but outstanding. They have a whole line of small, covert self-defense and tactical knives. You know, they're totally unapologetic about the fact that these are weapons. Mm-hmm. And then they have a full line of larger tactical weapon-like knives. And then they have a full line of outdoors knives that cross over, like the Silent Hero, a 5.75-inch drop point, beautiful, beautiful, big, broad blade. It reminds me of a Barong, which is a Filipino short sword. But these knives, I mean, just go look at the Tops page on any website or just go to Tops themselves. And you'll be shocked at how many models they pump out. It's amazing. And some of them are crazy. Like there's this giant, looks like a sickle almost. It's a huge, like 7.5-inch karambit that it's comical. It looks like it's out of a horror movie, but for sure it's built to work, you know. Right. Or you could just get the simplest, most plain looking bushcraft knife from them. So Tops knives, you know, you can. They dip below 100, but they hover pretty much around 100, 110, and then they right. go up from there.
Okay. Well, you mentioned a couple of reviews of some of these knives. Do want to remind our listeners that you can find Bob's knife review videos as well as the podcast, other special videos at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. If you aren't yet subscribed to the YouTube channel, that way you can get notifications and have the videos pop right up. Go to theknifejunkie.com/YT subscribe. That's, of course, stands for YouTube subscribe. So theknifejunkie.com/YouTube, or to subscribe, theknifejunkie.com/YT subscribe. So where are we at, Bob? Close on time here. Or we have any more knives? Or
well, I just want to talk a little bit about folders, and I have some examples, but I want to make some recommendations. For folders that are going out into the field and seeing heavy use, I would avoid folders with ball bearing pivots. Though in regular life, you know, walking around and just having them in your pocket, they work beautifully, and the action is admirable, and they're a pleasure to use and to fidget with. But ball bearings can be very fidgety. They can get very finicky, I should say. You get sand in there, or grit, or grime down in there, and then it will not be pleasant. Mm-hmm. So I say avoid ball bearing pivots. Stick with washers. I prefer the bronze, you know, phosphor bronze washers, because they can get super smooth, but they're just more stable. They keep the blade more stable. I would say stay away from super steels that are too difficult to sharpen out in the field. I would say bring a knife that has a good compromise of edge retention, sharp edge that you can actually get on that steel, and then price. So, you know, we look down our nose at OS 8 or 8CR13 MOV, and with with fair reason, but if you need to resharpen those, if you're using your knife a lot and you need to resharpen, it's going to be a pain in the butt if you have M390. Of course, the argument is, well, you won't have to resharpen as much. And I accept that. But again, a knife with M390 steel is going to run you a lot of money. And do you really want to be banging around that expensive knife out there? You want to risk losing a knife with M390 steel. I say stick with your, your nice steels, 154 mm-hmm. cm. Something like
that. Well, and again, the purpose of this show is to kind of look at the less expensive knife options that there are available. You can, of course, go anywhere that you've talked about and up.
Yes.
But again, the focus of this show is to really look at the most economical and functional for what you can get for the least amount of money.
Yeah. So get something with robust handles. I would say get something that has liners. I would say not to get a linerless GRN handles, for instance, and get something that is somewhat neutral that you can use in many different grips. And here's another one. It's counterintuitive, but automatic knives, folding knives are very resilient. That spring in there it's harder to jam than you think. And, especially if it's a good switchblade, a good automatic, like a ProTec. And, there are videos out there you can see with people, endorsing ProTec. I'm thinking of one video in particular where a serviceman lost his knife in mud and found it later, and it, without even cleaning it, it clicked out just like it was brand new.
What a testimonial.
What a testimonial.
Yeah.
And here's one other thought, and that is maybe you bring, if you can, a couple of throwaways. Maybe you bring a bunch of cold steel working man or ProLite knives. Great knives, use them, and don't worry about losing them. And if you do, you just replace it. That's a thought I had. I don't know how practical that is to just be walking around with a bunch of, or not walking around, but to be shipping out with a deep bench of pocket knives. It's probably not realistic. But if it is,
let us know if it is or if it isn't. If you're an active duty military person or a veteran, and love to hear your thoughts about that. Again, I'll put a plug in for the listener line. Call and leave us a message. Leave your recording. We'd love to hear from you. 724-466-4487. Again, 724-466-4487. And get some feedback on that thought, Bob. Interesting question.
Yeah. So anything from Cold Steel is going to be great. The Recon One, the American Lawman. CRKT has the Homefront series, which is their series of field strippable knives. You can take them apart with two easy steps out in the field, clean it up in the stream, and then put it back together. That's an interesting concept, and I'd be interested to see if anyone's actually used that out in the field. Ontario Rat Number One, we were talking about that. But the two last tools I want to talk about are for the corpsmen and the medics. There is the Leatherman Raptor, which is an amazing, I bought one for, Kurt Zepeda, our recent guest who was an EMT, but it's a pair of medical scissors that has been given the Leatherman treatment. So they fold and they open up and they have numerous other tools built into the handle. But it's a pretty robust and, multi-purpose tool, but it's built on the medical scissors platform. You know, those kind of scissors that can slip under bandages and have that weird angle to them.
Right.
So, I think for corpsmen, medics, the Leatherman Raptor would be a great knife to take. Also, Benchmade. I haven't mentioned Benchmade today, and because they tend to be expensive, but they have two knives that are really compelling. They have the Triage, which has a blade. A regular blade on one side. You can also get it blunted for the kind of operations you might be doing where you don't want to accidentally poke someone with the tip of the blade. Because these are, as the name elicits, triage. These are knives for medics and for EMTs and such. And on the back, it has a fold-out seatbelt cutter, which I think is really cool. And then just this past year, they came out with the Outlast. I really like this knife. I haven't held it yet, but I like the idea of it. It is a double-bladed knife. It's a Benchmade, an Axis Lock Benchmade. Well, it's an Axis Lock Liner Lock Benchmade. It's got two blades sitting side by side. One of them is a nice-looking draw point, and the other one is a blunted tip, wavy-shaped blade. And on the waves, there are serrations. And that equals double serrations.
Wow. Sounds cool. That's,
yeah. So that's two blades side by side, which you never see in modern tactical folders. Mm-hmm. And then on the back, you still have that third flip-out tool, the seatbelt cutter. So the Outlast, man, it looks really compelling. I'm not sure how pocketable it is because it's thick. I haven't really investigated that, but I just think that would make a great you'd right. feel very sure having that in your pocket.
Right. Okay. Well, before we get you to do a wrap up of the kind of the knives we talked about here, the fixed blades, some folders, and the multi tools, do want to remind folks to stay tuned because we're going to remind you about how you could win a knife from Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco. Now there is a time limit on this, so hopefully you're listening to the podcast sooner than later. If you're listening in the archives or past the May 29 date, well, we're sorry, but we'll talk about a knife giveaway. So I wanted to get that tease in there, Bob, but kind of wrapping it up here on combat knives, fixed blade folders, multi-tools, key takeaways, final thoughts, kind of what do you want to kind of end up on our topic today?
Well, I would say it's obvious, but I would just say don't take anything that's too precious to you. You might lose grandpa's knife somewhere overseas and regret it. Keep it affordable to you in case you lose it or have to replace it. And maybe not too tempting to sticky fingers. But keep it utilitarian. But remember, it's also a fighting knife. Mm. It's a combat knife. And just think about the K-bar, what it was called before it was called the K-bar. It was called knife, fighting, utility.
Pretty much says it all right there.
I mean, right there.
The perfect lesson in marketing or advertising, name it what it is, you know, right?
Exactly.
Cool. Interesting show, Bob. I learned a lot, especially about that, the K-bar.
The K-bar. I killed a bar.
I love that story. Like I said, don't know if it's true, but that's a great story, so we're going to stick with it.
It'll do until the real story gets here.
Cool deal. So I kind of teased it a moment there, but Bob, you have a video up. And again, preface this by this show comes out Memorial Day weekend. So we have a drawing on Wednesday, May 29th.
Yep.
The Knife Junkie YouTube channel crossed that 1,000 subscriber mark, kind of a historic mark there in the life of a YouTube channel. So you're giving away a knife, and the drawing is going to be on Wednesday, May 29th, but you have to be a YouTube subscriber and leave a comment. Kind of give us all the details. Yeah. Tell us a little bit more about it.
I was really racking my brain about what I should give away, and I almost decided to give away a pink cold steel broken skull with a snaggletooth on it, which is a knife I talk about and carry all the time. But then I realized, you know, just because I like pink knives right. doesn't necessarily – and I didn't want it to be like, oh, I won this blade, but it's kind of a buzzkill because I can't stand it because it's pink, but it's such a great knife. So I decided that the other knife that I've been carrying a lot and I have just fallen in love with is an unusual one for me. It's a Benchmade. You know, I don't really fall in love with Benchmades, but I did fall in love with the Benchmade Bug Out. And I recently got these amazing micarta replacement handles for it, which means I really love it because I'm spending more money on it than it needs to be spent on it. But so I got the green handled, gray bladed Benchmade Bug Out to give away. And all you have to do is be a subscriber or subscribe to the Knife Junkie YouTube channel and just leave a comment. Simple as that. It doesn't have to be a witty comment. Right. It just has to be something that so I can verify that you're a subscriber and so that I could put your name in the hopper and we're going to do a random number draw.
Oh, okay. So you'll assign numbers to the comments in the order in which they came in and
exactly.
then do a random name, random number generator to pick the winner.
That's exactly right.
Okay.
Yep.
So if you're not subscribed yet to the Knife Junkie YouTube channel, again, thenifejunkie.com/YT subscribe, knifejunkie.com/YT subscribe. Subscribe, leave a comment. Like Bob said, you don't have to praise Bob. You can criticize him. You can just say hi.
Yeah, but you won't get picked if you criticize him. No, I'm kidding.
Whatever the comment is, get that comment in there and have a chance to win the Benchmade Bug Out. And tease another giveaway we'll do later, but you've got some snaggletooth stuff we're going to do a video about and give away in another week or two.
I do indeed. I'm ashamed to say it sat on my desk a long time. Rob Penna, a two-time guest on this show, sent me the full Cog Ring / Snaggletooth MF pocket deployer. package. So it's a two product package. He sent it to me 2 months ago now to give away. And my desk has a lot of knife stuff on it. And I'm ashamed to admit it got a little lost in the clutter. But yeah, so we're going to be giving that away. And I in the video, I will demo it on a cold steel Tanto, Recon 1 Tanto.
Mm, okay.
But it doesn't come with a knife.
Gotcha. TheKnifeJunkie.com/YouTube. Check out all those videos and more. And again, to get in the drawing to win the Benchmade bug out, go to TheKnifeJunkie.com/YouTube. If you're already a subscriber, find that video and make a comment. If you're not subscribed, TheKnifeJunkie.com/YT. Subscribe. If you want, click that little bell notification. That way you can get a notification every time Bob puts out a new video. And then don't forget, leave that comment for your chance to win the Benchmade bug out.
And just a note, Jim, 12 o'clock noon. I mean, I mentioned it in the video, but 12 o'clock noon is when I stop, because I'll have to compile that list and I don't have a secretary.
And that's noon Eastern time.
Yes, noon Eastern Standard Time.
So if you're on the West Coast, I know that's 9 a.m.,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. 3 hours back. So yeah, so keep that in mind. Subscribe and comment early. Don't push, you know, that noon time clock, because Bob's noon might be your 11:59. So noon on Wednesday, May 29th. Good point there, Bob. Going to wrap it up. Any final thought? What do you want to leave our special show with today?
I just want to, again, thank not only the veterans who have sacrificed everything and who we're remembering this weekend, but also the men and women in uniform today who are serving right now, so that we can be sitting here talking about knives.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And again, remind you that our special sponsor for this show has been Ebates. If you'd like to get $10 for just joining, go to theKnifeJunkie.com/cashback. That's CASHBACK, theKnifeJunkie.com/cashback. After you spend $25, you'll get 10 of that back. Thanks so much to them for sponsoring it. Bob, thanks. Great show. I love, again, the K-Bar story, and good roundup of knives, though, here on the Knife Junkie Podcast. Thanks for listening, everybody.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at ReviewThePodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, TheKnifeJunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at TheKnifeJunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on TheKnifeJunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at TheKnifeJunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to Bob at TheKnifeJunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.